The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Assalamu alaikum everyone. Hello, how are you? And a very good morning to all of you people. And today is going to be our last day for this session, day 5. Let's start the session. Yesterday, when we completed day 4, we were actually on a role of accounting, right? So in today's session, we're going to complete our role of accounting chapter. The first topic we'll explore today is big data. You know, what is big data? As the technology is all evolving, we are using social media, we are using different websites and WhatsApp and all that stuff. Data is increasing day by day. We are posting things, we are commenting, liking, reacting, making online transactions. This all is called big data. And you know why it is big data? Because it has 4 V's in it. When a data is called big data, because when it has 4 V's. V number one is volume. The first characteristic of big data is it is of huge volume. The next characteristic is its variety. It's in different form. For example, it can be form of a photo, or it can be in the form of a react, or you can like, right? And there can be the third characteristic of big data is velocity, right? It comes in so much speed. The third characteristic of big data is velocity, right? The data is being generated in so much speed, like every moment there are millions of likes and photo postings and video postings and sharing and comments and transactions. So the big data is huge. That is volume. And it is creating it at a very high speed, that is velocity, right? But there is another V, fourth V, that is called veracity. What is veracity? Veracity means that there is a question on this big data is question of accuracy. You see, as big data is having so much big data, there's so much big data, there's so much data around. So what happens when there's so many when there's so much data around us, what happens? There's a problem of authenticity. Not all the big data we receive on social media is authentic. Next, we have artificial intelligence. You know what happens? This is very one of the growing topic these days, that is artificial intelligence. Because what happens with artificial intelligence, that artificial intelligence is a concept which defines that the capacity of the machine to think. Most of the times people can confuse it with robotics. Robotics is something different. Robotic means a task which usually was done by humans now to be done by machines. So robotics, ATM could be a difference, because once the task was being done by cashier, now that same task is being done by ATMs. But artificial intelligence is thinking process, right? So okay, this artificial intelligence contains technique of machine learning, right? What happens when we keep on doing so many things, we start to learn. So same goes for machines. When a machine does anything again and again and again, it starts to learn. Then there is image recognition. What happens when we meet someone? We understand them through, we recognize them through their face. And that is what we call, that is the same process which is happening in our mind, and the same thing will happen in artificial intelligence as well, in which machines will use cameras to have image recognition. Then there is a concept of speech recognition. Same goes with the humans. We humans interact with each other and we recognize each other with our voice, right? Same goes for machines. Machine will try to recognize humans and other people with their voice or speech recognition. And there's a deep learning as well. Deep learning means doing something in different ways and finding out the right option. So these, this all machine learning, speech recognition, and image recognition, this all sums up into artificial intelligence. So we can say in a summary that artificial intelligence is kind of a process in which a machine starts to think, right? Then there's another option, and there's another topic which we have got, that is accounting packages. What happens that usually accounting packages are called, also called computerized accounting softwares, and there are so many computerized accounting softwares these days people are using, like Peachtree accounting, Tallybooks, and all that stuff. So what, how these accounting packages can help us out? They can help us out in making profit or loss statements, right? Professional accounts, for example, we want to make profit and loss product wise. Now you've got 32 products. It would be very difficult for you to make 32 different income statements. But if you have accounting package, you can make 32 different profit and loss accounts of different products, 32 different income statements of different products, and with just a one click away. Same goes for a statement of financial position. You can have financial position on weekly basis, right? It is very difficult for the accountant to make a financial statement on the basis of weekly basis, but if you have accounting packages, things can become easy for you. Accounting packages can also help us to track aged receivable analysis, what kind of debtors we have, and what is the liquidity position we have, right? And list of amounts owing from customers, what we need to receive, what is the amount we have to receive from the customer, then what is the amount we have to pay to suppliers, and all these things can be done easily with accounting packages. Next topic we have is cloud computing. If we talk about cloud computing, you see what happens, that there are two options we can manage any data or a process or function. One is any department can be managed in two ways. Either we can have it on site. On site means you have a particular PC. For example, you have got an on site accounts department. So what do you do in on site accounts department? You place a computer, a software, an accountant, a cashier, and you need to create the whole entire department, right? That is called on site. But on the other hand, you can have an option that is called cloud based accounting. What is cloud-based accounting? You don't need to set up the entire department. What you need to do is to take or subscribe yourself with any accounting or cloud-based accounting firm, which can give you services online, and you only need a cashier and a computer and then fast internet. Your cashier will process the voucher and will submit to the internet to that accounting software company, which is giving you the cloud accounting software. What happens? They will process your data and give you the financial statement. You don't need to set up the entire department for yourself. So cloud computing can be very useful if you have any shortage of space and you don't want to handle the entire department of accounts. So this is could be an option for you. But there are some problems as well. For example, there is an increased dependency on the internet, because if at some point of time internet is not working, you'll face the problem in it, right? Any question in this big data, artificial intelligence, accounting packages, or cloud accounting? Okay. Variety. If we talk about the variety of big data comes in different shapes, right? For example, sometimes it comes in the form of photo or comment or video or review or star rating transaction. So we are creating online data, big data in different forms, right? Is this clear now? Then there was another question regarding to the AI with any example, right? So you're asking, okay, for example, usually what happens when you go to a lawyer for any small purposes, the lawyer gives you the idea or consultation what to do in this particular case. But through AI, what we can do, we can develop such computer programs which can guide people regarding their legal assistance. So instead of a lawyer, you will have software which will tell you your legal problem issues, solutions to those issues, right? This could be a possible use of artificial intelligence to replace human thinking with machine thinking. Is this clear to Mason, who actually asked this question? Next topic we've got here is control, security, and audit, right? You see, we need to differentiate between external and internal audit. This is, I think, one of the most important topic of external and internal audit. Usually what happens with external audit, if we talk about external audit, express an opinion, right, in the form of what you can say audit report, whether the financial statements are shown true and fairly. This is the purpose of the external audit. And if you talk about internal audit, the internal audit is there to improve the efficiency, the performance of the organization, how they identify risk and they put control over it. When risks are controlled, managed in a better way, what happens? It increases the performance of the organization. So this is the difference between external and internal audit in terms of reason. If we talk about appointment, right, then we can say that external auditors are appointed by shareholders. External auditors are appointed by shareholders through voting. Internal auditors are appointed by management. If you talk about responsibility, external auditors report to shareholders in the form of audit report. Right? And if you talk about internal audit, they report to BOD, usually audit committee. In terms of objectives, if we discuss, the objectives of external audit are defined by statute. Statute means law, And currently, the UK law is Company Act. On the other hand, internal auditors functions, purposes, procedures, how to do their job and all that stuff, this to be defined by management or audit committee, what you can say. If you look upon the relationship status of the auditors with company, external auditors should be independent of the company and its management, and there should not be any personal or business relationship between auditor and director, right? But if you talk about internal auditor, they are the employees of the company, they have a particular relation. So this was actually what you can say, the overall structure of external internal audit and their differentiation as well. Now, if you talk about internal controls, as I told you that internal auditors, what they do, they identify risk and then put control. These are some of the famous internal controls in order to what you can say, define them, and in order to remember, right? We can make this mnemonic, and that mnemonic is SPANSOAP, SPANSOAP, right? And it could be number one, it is segregation of duties. What is segregation of duties? Segregation of duties is a process in which we divide authority among different people. Rather than giving entire authority to some one person, I repeat, rather than giving entire authority to any single person, we divide that authority among different people so that this division of authority decreases the risk of fraud. So this is the segregation of duties. Moving forward, next we have physical controls, door locks, keys, passwords, watchman, and all that stuff. That is, which stops someone from any sort of physical or logical access. That is called physical controls. And there could be an option of there is an option of authorization and approval. What happens that we define the level of authority of different people, right? Who is authorized for what? For example, if I say you that from 0 to 50,000, such checks to be signed by accountant, and those checks above 50,001 to 1 lakh to be signed by senior manager, and that goes on. So there is, what you're trying to do is you're trying to define the authority limit of different people, which makes sure that nobody has so much authority or more than required authority to do some any sort of what you can say irregularity or fraud or something like that. Third one we've got is management controls. What is a management control? It's a control in which you can say administrative controls, right? These are the administrative controls which create, which are there to actually implement any sort of policies. And there are some supervisory controls. Supervisory controls are those controls in which we apply some people who monitor others. Like for example, during an examination, there is an invigilator. You can call invigilator a supervisory control because the invigilator has the duty to monitor the activity of different people. So if in your organization there is someone who is watching on the or having a monitoring over the activities of people, that is what we call supervision. We talk about organization as a control. So we can say that organization as a control means being organized also reduces so many risks. So what happens if you are organized, you are well organized in terms of time, in terms of resources, right? In terms of every other things which is required to conduct an activity. So the more organized you are, the lesser the chance of a problem will be there. If we talk about the seventh point, that is mathematical and accounting control, anything, any sort of control which increases the accuracy level of the organization's information. For example, if you make bank reconciliation statement, what bank reconciliation statement does, it increases the accuracy and authenticity of cash book. So we can say it's an accounting and automatic control because it is creating and increasing the efficiency and accuracy of the data. Number next we have is personnel control. Personnel means people, like employees. Personnel controls are those controls which are designed to make sure that people are being monitored properly. For example, whenever we hire a new person, we cannot give him the entire authority at the start of the day or start of the career. We give him authority step by step, step by step. For example, we have just hired a new cashier. So it's advised to allocate him a smaller branch as a being a junior accountant, junior cashier, right? So what happens when he starts to work for some time and then you can, then he starts to have more trust over his activities, then you can assign him larger activity. So this is what we call personnel controls. Next topic we've got is internal checks. We talk about internal checks. These are the checks which we apply on day-to-day activities, right? These are the checks which we apply on day-to-day transactions. And these transactions, for example, if you go to bank and you submit some amount over there, there's a risk that bank might disagree with you in future that you haven't deposited anything. Then what is your proof? If I ask you this question, what is your proof? Yes, deposit slip. One of the students responded that you can use deposit slip. Then what is that deposit slip? Actually, you deposited money in the bank and that was a transaction, right? And that transaction had a check that whenever or whoever deposits any amount in the bank, they receive a deposit slip as an evidence of money submission, right? So this is an internal check. Internal control on transaction, just to make sure risk does not occur there. Okay, now there are three types of internal checks we have. Number one, pre-list. We can have transactions before the we can have internal checks before the transactions. Those checks which we conduct before transactions are called pre-list. There are some checks we conduct after the transaction. Those are called post-list. And there are some controls which we use as a total. For example, what we do in bank reconciliation, we use the total of cash book and compare it with the total of bank statement. And when these totals are equal, it means our cash book is working well. We have recorded all the things in cash book. So what we do, we compare the total of same thing which are recorded in two different occasions or two different locations. And when we compare it and make it equal, or when we make when we reconcile them, this is called a control total. A control in which totals of the same things are compared, and if they are same, it means it is working correctly. If you talk about features of internal audit, there are two distinguished features an internal audit should have. Number one, internal auditor should be independent. Independent means being neutral. He should be working without any fear or pressure or what you can say. Right? So if someone is working as an internal auditor, pressureless, fearless, and he does not, he's not having any personal issues or anything, that is called independent. And what that is what we expect from an internal auditor. And if we talk about the second point, that is appraisal. Appraisal means internal auditor is supposed to check and test the work of other people, the activities of other people. They're not supposed to do things themselves, because if they do things themselves, who is going to check them? So what we expect, any activity should be done by, let's say, accountant, and that is check one, and then it should be checked by internal auditor. That is check two. When we help two check, it will create more accuracy. Any question regarding this controls, internal checks, and features of internal controls? Any question? There's a question, and the student asking for the example of tree list. Tree list means any sort of transaction accounting check or control check which is to be done before the transaction, right? I give you an example. For example, you're going to buy some goods from a supplier, right? First time. For example, you are an organization and you are planning to purchase some raw material from a supplier on credit, right? But supplier is having some fear. Obviously, they are giving you credit. They have some reservation. So what they did, they ask you for your financial statements. They ask you for your audited financial statements before the credit transactions takes place, just to confirm that you are sound financial enough, you are financial stable enough, and you will return back the loan. And all this checking will be done before the transaction. That is an example of pre-list. I hope this serves the purpose. That was question from Ariba. Another question we have, that is from Sanjana, and she's asked about the appraisal example. For example, accountant is going on liquidation. Then now the senior management have asked the internal auditor to do the task themselves, because if they can check others' work, they can do it as well. Internal auditor should not do it. Because what happens if internal auditor will do it himself, then who is going to check his task? So what we want to do, that we want to make sure that anyone else other than internal auditor will do the task and will check also. And after the checking and doing the task, internal auditor will recheck the whole task again. And this will increase the accuracy of the process. I hope this serves the purpose. Next topic we have, identifying and preventing fraud. So it's a very interesting topic in terms of accountancy, because what happens that usually fraud occurs in an organization in relation to finance department. Most of the times you find relation of fraud with the finance department. So as far as finance department is concerned, they have to be very much agile, they have to be very much on their toes, right? What are the possible types of fraud which can occur? Number one is theft of cash. The cashier left the drawers open and he went for lunch, and in his absence anyone can have a bite on that cash, right? And there could be possible theft of stock because of the irregularities in the storeroom department, and there is not much enough security over there. So there could be a theft of stock. There could be a payroll fraud, because what happens when we do not properly record the in and out of the employees, this fraud can occur. And number four, there's a problem of fictitious customer. Fictitious means fake. What happens when in an organization there could be people who make fake slips, fake customer vouchers, right? And this is how they can manipulate the accounts. Sometimes what happens, organization pay for something which never received. For example, somebody when there's an example that organization might have paid for something which was supposed to be used for official purpose, and instead of official purpose, it was used by directors for personal purpose. So what we say? So what happened that it was supposed to be used for official purpose, right? It was supposed to be used for official purpose, but it was done for, but it was utilized for personal purpose. So organization paid for something which was not received for organization, but in fact it was received by directors themselves and they use it for personal purposes. Then we have meeting budgets and targets. Sometimes what happens, people manipulate the budgets and targets in a fake manner, right? And they showed to the management that actually they have received a target, but in reality, they have not achieved the target. So they just manipulate, they create fake data, they create fake transactions sometimes. Sometimes they create fake information just to pretend that they have achieved the target. Next, disposal of assets to employees. It is a very common fraud. Like for example, there's an organization who has an old van in it. So they decided to sell it out. They asked for an employee to sell it. And what is the market value? He said it's a market value of $10,000, but actually the market value was $12,000. Right? So what happens? The organization asked the employee to sell it out. The employee said, okay, if you want to sell this, why don't you sell it to me? Right? So the employee showed the market value. This is the reported value. This is the reported value, and they showed the value. This is the reported value, which was fake. This was the actual market. So what happens? The van which had a market value of actual market value of 12,000, it was reported to management as if it is a value of having 10,000. And when the organization decided to sell it out, the employee requested to the management to please sell this to himself. And he purchases the van for $10,000 from organization and then afterwards sell it back to the market for 12,000. And gain 2,000 profit, and it obviously it's a fraud because he never reported the true value of the organization, true value of the van to the organization. Then there is a concept of overvaluation stock. Sometimes what happens, in order to get more from insurance company, if organization overvalue their stock. The actual value of the stock was 10,000, but in order to receive more benefit from insurance company, they showed it 12,000. Insurance company pay back them 12,000, although they had an actual loss of $10,000. So this is how they can manipulate the stock value in order to get better benefit or more benefit from the other stakeholder. Another fraud could be manipulation of air and yield. What happens is at the end air, so many events happen, and sometimes directors manipulate those events. Sometimes they increase the cost, sometimes they reduce the cost, sometimes they omit any event from shareholders just to have just to make sure that shareholders are feeling good for the organization. And this manipulation of events is also a fraud. If we talk about number three, that is the manipulation of depreciation figures. Sometimes the management of the organization manipulate the depreciation figures, right? They don't show the right amount of depreciation. This manipulation depreciation changes the level of profit, and that level of profit change can lead to the tax evasion. Any question in this in this types of fraud, we can label it. There's a question from student that, sir, theft of cash, is this from, it could be from petty cash, it could be from cashiers, a normal cash, it could be from any cash. Okay, somebody asked to repeat the second last option is manipulation of air and event. What happens that at the end of the air, so many event happens, this will change the entire structure of the fiscal year. Because I give you an example. For example, organization is having a good whole year, right? They had a very good January, February, let's say February, January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October. But they had two bad months of November and December. All were positive, 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 positive. But last 2 months were negative. As you know, that there is a perception of whatever happened at the last keeps, the people keep it in their mind. So directors are having a fear that if these two negative events will go to shareholders, they might change their opinion about the performance of director. So they manipulated it and make it positive events. But last dues, these two positive events are actually manipulated. So directors try to have a better end of fiscal year to give a better and positive impressions to shareholders. Is this clear? It is the same activity when, if you remember, then when you were giving your exams of 10th grade or 11th or 12th grade, you always try to do good questions at start and good questions at end, so that examiner might have a positive impressions towards you, right? This is the technique which you were applying in your school days, just to have a better impression management in front of examiner, right? Many of you have been asked by your teachers to attempt the best question at the start of the paper. And it should also be, technique should also be applied at the end of the paper as well. Just to create a positive overall image in front of the examiner, right or not? Next, there was a question on payroll fraud. Payroll fraud means not correctly calculating the pay of the employee. For example, somebody have actually worked for 8 hours and he's receiving the pay of 12 hours. These 4 hours are additional and he's actually not doing the job. He's manipulating his timings and attendance in the company. So this is a payroll fraud. You are actually doing work of 8 hours and you being paid for 12 hours, right? Any question in this regard? If you talk about assessing the risk of fraud, there are multiple factors which can help us out whether there is fraud is happening or not. For example, we talk about doctors. We know that that doctors are being taught about the symptoms. Why do we teach doctors about different symptoms of the disease? Can anyone tell me? Any idea? Doctors are being taught about different symptoms of different medicine, different disease. And we can answer this. You know what happens when we talk about different doctor and their services and their training stuff? We see that they have been taught about symptoms of different disease. Why? In order to early detect the disease. The earlier the detection, the easier the handling. I repeat, the earlier the detection of disease, the easier the handling of disease. So there is another symptom. There are symptoms of fraud as well, and there could be four possible areas where symptoms of fraud occurs. There could be some external factors. There could be some factors outside the organization, like technological development. If there's so much technological development outside the organization, organization have to develop themselves as well. For example, you are a bank, and there is so much development in ATM. In the society, you need to upgrade your ATM as well, otherwise they will be hacked and you can lose so much money. If you talk about internal factors, these are some of the factors which are inside the organization, right? Internal software change. What happens when an organization changes its software internally? That the new software might have some bugs. And people having knowledge of IT can utilize those bugs to conduct a fraud. So whenever organization changes its internal software, they need to find out if there are any bugs. And if there are any, we need to remove it. We need to do debugging. That's called debugging. Try to find out the bugs as much as possible and try to solve the solution. Before any person who having high knowledge of IT will utilize those bugs. Okay, there's a student asking about the MTQ session. We will conduct this MTQ session after this slide. After here, right? After two slides. We'll conduct the MTQ session. I've got some three, four MTQs, and we'll solve those MTQs on screen so you can have an idea of MTQs, right? And there's a third area that is called business. Those risks which are particularly related to any particular field. Right? If you talk about, for example, if I ask you that there is a risk of paper leakage, exam paper leakage. If I ask you, there is a risk of exam paper leakage. So if I ask you, what is this industry? What are the types of organization where this risk can occur? If I ask you, paper leakage risk, will it happen in every industry or any particular industry? Will it happen in every field or any particular field? Of course, this can happen in educational field only. This will not happen in manufacturing industry. So these are the kind of risks which are related to particular business risk, operational risk, day-to-day activity risk, which are particularly related to particular activities. And the fourth one is personnel risk. Personnel risk are related to people. Like, for example, if someone's, I'll give an example, if someone's level of lifestyle is not matching with his level of income, then there is a chance that that person might, I'm not saying always or confirm, but I'm saying there's a chance that that person might be doing some fraud. If he is earning lesser than his lifestyle, how is he managing the expenses? Right? Any question in this regard of this? Okay, next we have how to prevent fraud, right? How we can stop fraud from happening, right? Option number one, we can segregate duties or in task among different people. We should not give the entire authority to any single person, right? But we need to divide authority among different people, right? So what, instead of giving the entire authority to single person, divided among different people, that is what we call segregation of duties. And there are some authorization policies, whom should sign, who can sign, who can pay, who can receive. We need to define the authority of the people. There is a concept of customer signature, right? When we make a check, right? How to identify this check is okay. Obviously, we compare the sign of the check with the sign we have in our records. And if the sign matches, it means this check is genuine. So this is how we stop fake checks through customer signature. Number four is you better use words rather than numbers. You know, it's very easy to manipulate numbers. 1193. This 1193 can be easily done 1793. You see, it was actually 1193, but easily it can be made as 1793. You see, I deliberately did it with blue color so that you can identify it's very easy. But if it is written in words, 1193 only. Now, if it is written in word, it's very difficult to manipulate it. Fifth thing is to do the documentation. Do the documentation, everything. Receipts, voice, invoices, vouchers. Make documentation, everything. Number six, make a sequential numbering. 101, 102, 103. So that fake vouchers cannot be added in the book. Number seven, put on dates. If you have auto date printing on documents, then it will be difficult for the people to create fake vouchers, because it will be difficult for the people to do something on backdated. Like, for example, if I am right now, I am here, and today is January 26th, and I want to create some voucher of January. But if I have in my organization software an option of auto date generation, whenever I'll create the new voucher with the name of previous voucher, it will apply the current date. So it will be difficult for me to create backdated vouchers. Yes, I told you now that I will start it after point number 11. Right? Inshallah. Stay tuned. Number next, standard procedures. Whatever we do, that is what we say, we need to do it with the standard procedure. And there should be proper holidays given. And there should be proper recruitment policies. And whom should be responsible for and all that stuff. And there should be computer security as well. Like, for example, you need to install antivirus softwares, right? Firewalls to avoid unauthorized access. So that's it. Any question in this broad chapter? Then we'll start the MTQ session. Business risks are those risks which are particularly associated with any particular field or day-to-day activities. For example, if there is an organization having an activity of exam generating or testing, there is a risk of that test result or test paper might get leaked. So this is related to day-to-day activities. Okay, let me show you MTQ we're going to discuss. Okay. In your on your screen, you can see an MTQ. Right? Okay, this here are four references to the functions of management, right? A, these are okay. I give you 2 minutes to read it, then I'll solve it for you. Okay, now I'll solve task one. Okay, here are four. If I now I'm reading the question, here are four references to the functions of management. Okay, there are four questions, there are four statements, statement A, B, C, D. What they're asking, that if Peter Drucker is referring to what? Reference A, reference B. These are the four references which we can find here, right? Now we need to connect it. If we talk about the first line, that is, these, there are essentially five functions of management that apply to any organization, right? This was reference A. Where do you find this? Any idea? I ask you, what is being said by Peter Drucker? Okay, reference A was given by Henry Fiol, five functions of management, and there is no Henry Fiol in the list. So A does not match anywhere. Right? And if I want to connect with Peter Drucker, what Peter Drucker have actually said? Is related to reference. That is, the manager of a business has one basic function, that is economic performance. Because being a manager of an organization, you need to know the economic performance, whether we are generating enough amount of profit or not. That is what the sayings of Peter Drucker is. If you talk about Elton Mayo, where we can connect Elton Mayo? A, B, C, D. Okay, Elton Mayo, if you remember, Elton Mayo was more focused on behavior of the people, handling the people. Because they say, because they believe that communication, behavior, these all things make employees more motivating, and which increases the productivity. Next, we have Henry Mintzberg. Where we can connect Henry Mintzberg? Right, we do not find any teachings of Henry Mintzberg among these A, B, C, D. So we can say this could be none of the above references, right? And we talk about F.W. Taylor. The way we can refer to F.W. Taylor, A, B, C, D. Management is the development of true science of work, that is C. Right? So what happens when we connect the correct options, it will give you the marks. One important thing which we want to focus here is, they said management is the development of true science. You remember when I used to teach in my class, I also tell you the name of F.W. Taylor's theory. F.W. scientific theory, there's another name which I must have told you in class. Can anyone tell me the name? In book it is written scientific management, right? I also give you the name of that machine theory, the scientific theory given by scientific management theory given by F.W. Taylor. It's also called machine theory. Keep this in your mind, right? Okay, let's talk about task two. From the list below, identify two of Henry Fiol's functions of management. Planning, organizing, managing, monitoring, motivating. Two options given by Henry Fiol. Just to make sure that you only write options given by Henry Fiol. Remember, Henry Fiol gave five options. And should I speak? Okay, these are the two options, planning and organizing. These were the two functions given by Henry Fuel. What examiner is trying to trick you, he is giving motivating option here, right? But motivating option was not given by Henry Fuel, it was given by some other people after Henry Fuel. There were two additional options were given by other, there were two additional functions were given by other theorists. That was motivating and communicating. You remember that? Fuel functions had five functions, but later theorists added two more functions. But these additional two functions were not given by Henry Fuel. Okay, there is another empty queue in front of you. You read task one, then I'll discuss. I'll give you 2 minutes to read this whole thing, then I'll give you answer to it. Okay, there are a number of ways. I am starting to read the question. There are a number of ways of developing staff on a one-to-one basis with organization, right? We can develop staff through one-to-one. Each has its own strength and weakness. Every what you can say procedure has its own benefits and problems, and every it is an appropriate in different situations, and examples are given of coaching, mentoring, counseling, appraising, right? First, we will read the first area. That is an approach whereby a trainee is put under the guidance of an experienced employee who shows the trainee how to perform tasks. You remember the key point here was task. Whenever we teach someone how to perform a particular task, that is what we call coaching. Remember, keep this. This is the key point. The word task here performing task, it's a key point, right? If we read the second line, that is a long-term relationship in which a more experienced person encourage an individual personal and career development. Here, the keywords are long-term relation, because usually mentoring are long-term relationships. And it focuses on career and development skills. When we are focusing on skills in a long-term way, that is called mentoring. So here, the key point is, there are two key points. One is long-term and one is career development. If you read the third line, an interview, the aim of which is to review the performance, identify training and development needs. If you talk about training and development needs, right, because it was made to review the performance, and performance review, that is what we call appraising, as we discussed earlier in this chapter. And there's a fourth line that says, an interview to help another person to identify and work through a problem. When you are helping someone to know themselves, because sometimes what happens, people are not good in finding out the problems in their own. So when you are helping anyone, so they can find out a problem in themselves and can review that problem, that is called counseling. Any question in this regard? Okay. There is a task two as well. In organization, I'll give you 2 minutes to read and give me the answer. Then I'll discuss it. Okay, now I will read this. An organization uses mentoring as a form of one-to-one personal development, right? Which two of the following are benefits of this approach? So we need to find the benefits of mentoring, right? Two possible benefits of mentoring. One is the same career and personal development as I told you earlier, 2 minutes back, career and development. Career and personal development. And number two is providing a role model for an employee. Because what happens when an employee sees a senior person in front of him in a long-term relationship, it gives him the inspiration and helps them to follow the same path which they have been doing. Actually, mentors do not demonstrate the task. Coaching, what they do, coaching is a process in which we tell employee how to do that task. In mentoring, we don't tell them how to do the task. Actually, we develop their skills over the time. So you're talking about demonstrating how to perform. That is a benefit of coaching. A student said, why demonstrating how to perform? The last option is not the correct. Right? Any question in this regard? So I'll move to question. Next question for this. Next MTQ. Okay, next question we have, next MTQ is about a sport for kids. It's a charitable organization that operates a sports center in large city, right? And there's a question, and you need to read the question, and then you have to do the task one, and you need to identify the stakeholders discussed in the questions, whether they are internal stakeholders, connected stakeholders, or external stakeholders. Right. So reading this, for example, there are four stakeholders we will discuss: diet timer, management committee, four building companies, and local residents. We need to identify these stakeholders as in particular category of internal, connected, and external. Start reading, and then I'll give you answer after 2 minutes. Okay. Let's read the question. In para one, it is defined and identified about Dona and Dietmar. These were the two trustees. They do not participate internal day-to-day management. They are just in contact with the company, and whatever contract to be done on behalf of company will be done by these two. So these two, Dona and Dietmar, are not actually participating in day-to-day activities. Therefore, they are not internal stakeholder. They will be called connected stakeholder because they are in connection with the company. Any question in this part? Did you get it? Everyone, please. Dona and Dietmar were two trustees. As they were not involving in day-to-day activities and running the charity, they were in just contact. Right? Then there is a second para. They discuss about the management committee. These are the people who are actually responsible to running the overall affairs of the charitable organization, right? So they are clearly internal members of the management of committee, are internal stakeholders, right? Is this clear to everyone? As they are involved in day-to-day activities. And the para 3 says the management committee is negotiating with four building companies. So that management committee, which is an internal stakeholder, is negotiating and dealing with four building and construction companies. As they are not inside part of the organization, these four building companies are constantly in negotiation with us. They are called connected stakeholders. Right? And in the fourth para, it is written that the proposed expansion of the facilities has engaged the local residents. What happens because of this all extension and construction? The people who live surrounding are usually not happy with this. They're called local residents. So these local residents can be said external stakeholders because they are not in any sort of contract with the organization, and also they are not in the directly contact with the organization. So they can be considered as external stakeholders. Any question in this regard? Because they are in contact with the company, they are contractual stakeholders. Contractual stakeholders are those stakeholders which have particular contracts with our organization. They have contract relationship. We are negotiating with them. Once the negotiation successful, become the contractual stakeholders of the company. Any question? Okay, moving to task two. I'll give you 2 minutes to read this, then we'll discuss. I'll show you the options. This is power and interest level, and this is the communication strategy. Okay, let's discuss. Complete the following table about sports market stakeholders. What we need to do now, according to Mandlow's grid, we need to handle these two stakeholders. Stakeholder number one is building companies. Where we can put building companies? building companies have low power but high interest because they want to have business with our company. Low power because right now they are not having any contract with us, and there are four options for us. We can choose any one of them. So we are not heavily depending on them, right? So therefore they have low power, but all of them are willing to have a contract with us. Therefore we can say they are having low power with high interest with us. And what should be done with those who have low power and high interest? We need to keep inform them. This is what the Mandelow's power mapping structure taught us. And we talk about local residents. Local residents have high power and high interest because at any point of time they can go to court and stop the construction of the facility. So they've got high power. They can influence us through law, and they have high interest as well because they are living nearby. And obviously people are more interested about the surroundings, what is happening in their surrounding. And what to do with those who have high power and high interest? We need to treat them as key player, right? So this is it. Any question as regard? Okay, here we have another MTQ, and this MTQ is from ethics, right? And task one asks us click on four words out of these, right? These are the four words. Integrity. There are actually eight. These are actually eight words: integrity, honesty, trustworthiness, expertise, professional behavior, confidentiality, respectfulness, and objectivity. Which four of the following fundamental principles of ethical behavior? What IFAC? International Federation of Accountants expect from us. Read and identify four of them, which are given by IFAC. Okay. Number one, integrity, yes. Right. And next we have professional behavior, yes. Confidentiality, yes. And objectivity, yes. These are the four which are expected by ACCA. Fundamental principles, right? Any question? So we can move to task two. We can now task two. Select four factors in the list below which distinguish a profession from an occupation. Like there are two things. One is one is occupation. So how we distinguish among profession and occupation? How we can like account being accountant is a profession, right? Being a carpenter is an occupation. How we distinguish among a profession and occupation? I'll give you 2 minutes to read, then I'll take the correct question answers. ओके जी Okay, task two, select four factors in the list below which distinguish a profession from a qualification. What distinguish a profession from qualification as the professions have a process of certification. They have a proper process of certification, and you cannot be a part of a professional member without that certification. Number next thing is there is a particular association for every profession. Like ACCA has a particular, accountants have particular associations, right? Doctors have associations. So every profession have particular association which govern the whole profession. And they always work in, act in the public interest. Like if you are a, being a professional means I always look upon the public interest, right? And number four is, there are particular ethical codes of conduct. A person who is related to a particular profession is always controlled through code of ethics, as ACCA is also having a code of ethics. And every member of the ACCA is bound by those ethical standards or ethical code of conduct. Any question in this regard? Actually, if you talk about qualification by examination, both profession and occupation can have examination, right? If you're taking training of any occupation for from any organization, they can ask you for an examination as well. So it is not a differentiating point. Occupations can have examinations, they cannot have examinations, but we are just focusing on those factors which distinguish from are which are in the profession compulsory but not in occupation, right? Okay, here we are taking a break of 15 minutes and we'll be back by 12:50, inshallah. Okay. अस्सलाम वालेकुम, आपको मेरी आवाज आ रही है? ओके, नेक्स्ट वी हैव माइक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स. बिफोर एक्सप्लोरिंग माइक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स, फर्स्ट वी नीड टू डू, वी नीड टू नो व्हाट इज इकोनॉमिक्स. Right? Okay, there's a term, scarcity. Do any one of you know what is scarcity? Haan ji. Anyone having idea what is scarcity? Scarcity is anything where demand is greater than supply. For example, if any commodity has higher demands with lesser supply, that's what we call scarcity. And scarcity is about any product which has higher demands and lesser supply. And economics is all about dealing with scarcity. Right, because there is another concept that is called abundance. Abundance means anything which has lesser demand and higher supply. If there's a lesser demand, higher supply, there's no point of problem here, right? It's very easy to handle something which you already have more than required. So if you have anything which is more than requirement, that is called abundance. So economics is all about dealing with scarcities, because it's really very easier to handle them. So economics is the science of handling scarcities. And if we talk about economics, economics is further divided among two branches. One is micro and one is macro, right? Micro deals with individuals and organizations. And macro deals with entire economy, entire nation or country. Right? It's about entire economy, entire nation or entire country. Any question in this regard? Okay, next we have, okay, there's a question from student. He's asking about the number of questions which come in F1 paper or FBT paper. Just to have a quick view. There are two sections in F1 or FBT. Now the new name of the paper is FBT, right? Section A contains 46 questions of 1 or 2 marks each, right? That makes 76 marks in total. And there's a section B which contains 6 questions, which, and these all 6 questions, MTQs, come from each section of the paper, section of the syllabus. There are 6 sections of the syllabus, section A, B, C, D, F, right? That makes total a marks of 24. So 76 and 24, that makes 100%, right? It is just in a quick view, right? Coming back to our topic. Okay, we were discussing microeconomics, right? Microeconomics point number one, that is demand and supply. What is demand and supply? Demand contains two things. Demand is buyer's willingness and ability, right? What is demand? Demand means if the buyer is willing to buy something, as well as he or she has the financial ability to purchase it, then it is called demand. And if the buyer is willing to buy but he does not have enough money to it, then it is not a demand. It is what you can say want or something else. But demand should be backed up by two things. Number one, willingness, and number two, financial ability. And if you talk about supply, supply is seller's willingness to sell on particular price. So there are two things here. In order to be a supply, it is a willingness to sell something on a particular price. So there should be a particular price. If the seller is willing to sell something at a particular price, then it is called supply. Any question in this regard? Next, we have market, right? What is market? Market is where buyer connects seller, right? Market is something, is a place, or it is a location, or it is a communication, or it is a connection in between buyer and seller. A shop can be a market. An app, the Uber app, is also a market. It is a digital market through which you can engage a taxi service for you. An Amazon website is a market as well, because it is where you connect with seller. You can say Amazon website is a market, right? A phone call through which you order something, that is also a market. So market is anything through which buyer connects with seller. Is this understandable to everyone? Next, we have price theory, right? Okay, before asking the price theory or telling you the price theory, let me ask a simple question for you, right? Okay, I'm giving you the question. If I go to a shop and ask about the price of a fan and ask them, what is the price of this fan? He says, it's 3,000. And I say, no, 3,000 is too much. It should be 2,500. The seller asked for 3,000 and the buyer said 25. You, what is the price of that fan? What do you say? Seller is asking for 3,000 and buyer is offering 2,500. And if I ask you at this moment, what is the price of this fan? Yes, it is the amount agreed by seller and buyer. Till now, it is they have not agreed. But after some negotiation, they both get agreed on, let's say, 2700. Buyer agrees, seller agrees. And if they both agrees on 2700, we can say 2700 is the price. Because the 2700 is the figure on which both have agreed. Right? Is this clear to everyone? Next, we have got law of demand. What is law of demand? Law of demand is a buyer's thinking process. It is how a buyer thinks. It is something how a buyer responds. And what is this behavior? What is this law? If a price of a commodity increases, its demand decreases. Or a price of a commodity decreases, its demand increases. And this is what we call law of demand, right? Same what happens that, do you think what happens when the prices of pizza are decreased and there is a sale of pizza, buy one get one free? What happens? People rush to those restaurants where there are sales, there buy one get one free offer. Why is there so many people surrounding the restaurants? Why the demand has increased? Because the reason is the price have increased. Price have decreased. So when there's a decrease in price, there will be an increase in demand. And when there will be an increase in price, there will be a decrease in demand. Right? And if we talk about the law of demand curve, the demand curve, we can say this, if we can put price on y-axis, and we can put demand on x-axis, this could be the demand curve, right? But there are certain situations where law of demand does not work, right? There are certain situations where law of demand is not working. For example, what is law of demand? Law of demand says if a price of a commodity increases, its demand decreases, right? But sometimes what happens, that price of the product is increased and demand is also increased because the income have increased. What happens when people have more income, when people receive promotion from the organization, when people received higher salary from organization and if their income is increased, they tend to buy more expensive products. But in usual situations, what happens when price increases, demand decreases? In what is normal? In price increase, demand decrease. But if the income of the consumer have increased, there is a tendency of the consumer that he or she will go for more expensive products, even though the price have increased. They will tend to purchase it more and more, and that is because of increase of income. So we can say this is situation number one where law of demand does not work, where the income of the person have increased. Is it understandable to you? It's a very important point. You need to understand it. Okay, the second reasons why law of demand is not working, that is the preference of consumer, right? What happens, like, what is the usual law of demand? Price increase, demand decrease. But sometimes what happens, that price of a commodity is increasing and its demand is also increasing because it is in fashion. And when it is in fashion, every customer has a preference of purchasing it, even if it is expensive. When something comes into fashion, when something comes into the trend, when something becomes part of the trend, people try to purchase it more and more, even if it is expensive. And you know why? Because people have preference of it. of purchasing. People are demanding it because of the fashion. So fashion can be the second reason why law of demand does not work. Is this clear to everyone? Next, there are concept, the number of consumers in the market. What happens? What is law of demand? Price increase, demand increase. But sometimes what happens? Price increase, demand also increase because there are so many people in the market, right? When Eid is near or any occasion, there are so many customers in the market. And what happens when there are so many customers in the market, the seller starts to increase the price. And because there are so many people in the market, everybody try to purchase it. And as a result, demand also get increased. So prices are increasing as well as demand are increasing. And this is just because there are so many people in the market. It could be due to any occasion. It could be due to any urgency, right? Could be any reason. The point is that if there is higher number of consumers in the market, if there are higher number of buyers in the market, the price and demand both will increase. Right? Yes, Mohit, that is why I didn't give the example of that. I agree with you. Next, we have complementary goods. It's very important to know, understand what is complementary goods. Complementary goods are those goods which cannot be consumed without each other, which are compulsory for each other. For example, you cannot use electricity and AC separately, right? You need air condition as well as electricity. If you have electricity, do not have AC, there's a problem. If you have air condition but do not have electricity, there is a problem. You need both of them at the time. And when two products are required for each other to be consumed, such relationship among goods are called complementary goods. Can any one of you give me more examples of complementary goods so that we can confirm that whether you have understand it or not? Yes, quick. Any examples for this complementary goods? Okay, the students have started to give examples, and one is bat and ball, sugar and tea, car and petrol, bread and butter, shoes and socks, petrol and car, fast food and soft drinks. All examples are pretty much correct. Very good. Next, we have substitute goods. What are substitute goods? Substitute goods are those goods or those products which can be used in replacement of each other. Right? Substitute goods can be used in the replacement of each other. They can replace each other. For example, petrol and CNG. They can be used instead of each other, right? Or you can say tea or coffee. Any other examples? Somebody gave the example of DVD and CD. Yes, they can be used as a substitute. You can use CD or DVD in order to record your data. And there is an example of Pepsi and Coke. You can have Pepsi or Coke. I'll prefer Coke, right? And there's a substitute goods for sugar and honey, right? There's a example which is given by student, chocolate or sweet meat. I didn't get it. What is sweet meat? maybe something I'm not reading it properly. He gave the example of chocolate or sweet. Okay, chocolate or sweet is okay, but what is about? Okay, he's talking about mithai, the confectionery items, right? Halwa, whatever it is called in Urdu, it's called halwa, confectioners, right? Next topic we're going to explore is price elasticity of demand, right? You know what happens if you look around yourself, you would find so many different plastic products, right? And some plastic material are elastic, some plastic material are inelastic. So there are some plastics around you which you can bend, right? Which you can bend, but there are some plastic materials you cannot bend. And why? What is the reason why some plastic materials can be bended and some plastic materials cannot be bent? You would say, sir, it is the elasticity in those materials. Some plastic are elastic, they have elasticity, they can be bent, some are not. Same, there are some products which are having elasticity. For example, if you say price reaction to meat is something different, salt is something different. If meat becomes expensive, people purchase it less. If meat becomes cheap, people buy it high. But if you talk about salt, even if it gets expensive, people will buy it the same value or the same quantity which they were buying previously. And if the salt gets cheap and there's a reduction in the price of salt, nobody is going to buy more salt and putting more salt in the food. Because the demand of the meat responds more and the elasticity of salt is less. Right, next we have the law of supply. What is law of supply? Law of supply refers to the understanding and the principle that is called law of supply, and it is from seller's perspective, right? And what it says, if the price of a commodity increases, its supply also increases. If a price of a commodity increases, its supply also increases, right? And if the price of a commodity decreases, its supply also decreases. In order to understand law of supply, we need to think from seller's perspective, right? It is very crucial point. Right. So in overall perspective, we can say the law of supply means increase in price will result in increase in supply, and the decrease in price will decrease in supply. Now the question is, why does it happen? What is the mechanism behind this? So we can say, as an investor, you would only always try to invest in those areas where price and demand are also increasing at the same time. So if you are an investor and you've got, let's say you've got $50,000 to invest, so what you'll see, you will look at the market and you'll try to find those markets where prices are increasing as well as demand. For example, milk market. Even if the milk gets expensive, people have to buy it as well, even if it is getting expensive. So the price of milk is increasing and the demand of milk is increasing because it is necessity. So when a seller sees that there is a market where prices and demand both are increasing, he starts to invest in that market as well. He starts to produce that product as well. And when he starts to produce that product as well, the supply of a commodity increases. So we can say price increase, resulting supply increase. Did you get this point? It's a very critical point. We all need to understand this. Okay, we talk about law of supply. Sometimes it happens law of supply does not increase. What could be the possible factors? For example, possible factor could be, number one factor could be cost of production. If the cost of production have increased, law of supply will not work. What is law of supply? Price increase, supply increase. So when cost of production increases, the investor does not always have increased or additional resources to increase the production. As a result, production of the supply gets low. And if there is an increase in price and there's an decrease in supply, and why there is a decrease in supply? Because the investor does not have additional amount to increase the supply because of the inflation. So we'll say this is what we called the factor where law of supply is not working. Did you get this point? And the reason behind is cost of production. Is this clear to everyone? Next topic we have got is macroeconomics. As we discussed earlier, macroeconomics is something which deals with entire economy, entire country, entire nation. So microeconomics was dealing with individuals and single organization, and macro deals with entire economy, entire country, entire nation. So now we're going to explore macroeconomics. What is macroeconomics all about? From to understand macroeconomics, we need to think from the overall country perspective, right? The entire nation perspective. The first topic here we've got is aggregate demand. You see, in previous slides, we discussed demand. You see, here, we discussed demand. Demand refers to microeconomics, that is the requirement of individual, but aggregate demand refers to the demand of entire country. For example, if I say how much electricity is required by Procter and Gamble, electricity required by one organization, right? Electricity need of one organization is demand, is demand. And electricity need of entire country is aggregate demand. How much electricity is required? That is, how much electricity is required by one organization is demand. And how much electricity is required by the entire country is called aggregate demand. How much electricity is being produced by one company is supply. And electricity produced by all companies of a country is called aggregate supply. How much electricity is being produced or supplied by one organization is called supply of electricity. And how much electricity is being produced by entire country is called aggregate supply. Is this clear to everyone? Next, we have shift in aggregate demand. What is shift in aggregate demand? We can say it's variation in demand due to non-price factors. And it is variation in demand due to price. What is the difference? Difference is shift is because of non-price factor and change and is because of price. If the demand of a product is varying, there is a variation in demand of a product and that is due to non-price factor. What is the non-price factor? Non-price factor could be climate, weather. If people are purchasing more jackets due to winter, and winter is a weather, it is a non-price factor. So we can say this variation in jackets demand is shift in aggregate demand. And if people are purchasing jackets because there is a sale, there is a low price, then we'll say this variation in demand is due to, is called change in variation demand because it is due to price. Did you get this point? Is this understandable to everyone? Next, we have the fiscal policy. You see, every government makes a fiscal policy, right? And these fiscal policy covers three major areas, right? And those major areas, number one is expenditure, revenue, borrowing. So all those policies relating to these three areas are considered as fiscal policy. Three basic and major element of the fiscal policy. Number one, expenditure. If the government takes any policy or makes any policy, takes any decision which is related to expenditure. For example, government decided to increase the salary of government employees. So if the government is decided to increase the salary of government employees, obviously this will affect the expenditure of the government. So this is the part of the fiscal policy. What kind of expenditure needs to be made, right? And if you talk about the revenue, second point, right? So we can say every policy which is related to the revenue part of the government, for example, government decided to increase tax on any product. So this decision will increase the tax of any product, which will increase the revenue of the government. So therefore we can say it is a part of the revenue policy made by the government, right? And if you talk about the third part, that is borrowing. What is the borrowing part of the fiscal policy? The government has a policy where they decide what kind of borrowing policy or what kind of borrowing procedures we need to adopt. For example, government decided to go for loans with organization A and decided not to go to organization B, right? This is a borrowing policy. Government decided to go for interest rate 3 to 4. This is a part of the borrowing policy. Government decide to go for loans. Government decide not to go for loans. Government decides to go for short-term loans or long-term loans. All these policies relating to the borrowing perspective, from borrowing, that is called a fiscal policy. So these are the three major areas of a government to have policies, right? If I ask you a question, right? The government has decided to launch new bonds. The government have decided to launch new bonds. What is it? Expenditure, revenue, or borrowing? It's borrowing, right? Because when government issue bonds, government takes loans from the people in the form of bonds and then pay back the principal plus interest as well. Right? There's another question number two. The government has decided to increase import duty on cars. The government have decided to increase import duty of cars. Of which part of the fiscal policy it connects? Expenditure, revenue, or borrowing? You can write 1, 2, 3. Don't need to write the whole sentence, the whole expenditure, revenue, or borrowing. You can write 1, 2, 3 only. 1 or 2 or 3. Hello, students, can you hear me? Actually, there was a problem with my internet, so I connected with the second device. So there was an interruption of 2 minutes. Can you hear me now? If you can please answer, so I can continue my class. Okay. The next topic we're going to explore, that is function of taxation. And what are the functions of taxation? Because function is one of the very important element for any government. The reason number one why the government is to increase revenues for the government. What happens? Because government needs so much money to run their operations, right? And in order to control their and handle their expenses, they need to have so much revenue, and taxation is the biggest source of revenue for any government, right? This is reason number one and function of number one of taxation. Number two, tax are also used to discourage certain activities. For example, government does not want you to use high cc cars, 2000 cc, 3000 cc cars. So government, what they do, they put extra amount of tax on those products which government does not want you to use. So as a result of higher tax, people will not, and people will be discouraged to use those products. Number three, government also, monitors the social cost of so many products. Because what happens that there are so many products which are actually, which creates the image of someone's financial perspective. So government wants to discourage those products as those are used as a symbol of status and all that stuff. The government applies more tax on it. Reason number next of function of the functions of taxation is redistribute income and wealth. What happens when government applies tax? They try to redistribute and takes and receives larger tax or more tax from the wealthy people, and then redistribute the same tax to poor people in terms of free services or low priced utilities, free medical services and all that stuff. So actually, what is the function of tax here is to take extra income or extra tax from wealth or wealthy people and then giving it back to the poor part of the country. Second, next is to protect industries from foreign competition. What is point over here? This government sometimes applies import duty on imported items, so that imported items become expensive and people starts to purchase more and more domestic items. As a result, when there is an increase in items and when there is an increase in the sales of domestic items, this will help the domestic industry to grow more. So in order to support domestic industries, the government applies import duty on foreign goods, right? Next, we have to provide a stabilizing effect on national income, because what happens when you got so many deficit in the national income, right? And national income is going down and you need to increase that national income and we're having problem in handling it, you apply more tax. As a result, government has more revenues and these revenues can be used to stabilize the economy. Okay. Any question in this functions of taxation? No question. Okay, before there was an interruption, we were discussing and I asked you a question, right? And the question was, if the government have decided to put import duty on cars, what is the part of the fiscal policy government is addressing? Expenditure, revenue or borrowing? Answer could be 1, 2 or 3. Yes, this was a question which I was asking before that internet interruption. Yes, it's a part of revenue because more import duty will create more revenues for the government. Right? Answer number two. Next topic we're going to explore is inflation. Right? What is inflation? Inflation is a process, or inflation is an event where the price of the products gets increased. And this increase of price is called inflation. Right? Now, the second question is, there are two types of inflation. One, demand pull inflation. Two, cost push inflation. So if there is inflation in any market, and that is because of increased demand, and if it is because of increased demand, then we would say this is demand pull inflation. For example, if there is increase in prices of air condition due to summer, and you know summer, during summers air conditions have more demand, and as a result of more demand, air conditions becomes more expensive, then such inflation of price of air condition in summer is called demand pull inflation. But if it is due to increase in cost, for example, expensive component of any air condition, if you talk say compressor, if there is an increase in the cost of compressor, and the organization is purchasing more expensive compressor, and there is an increase in overall cost of the AC, then such inflation, which is due to increase in cost, if the demand have increased, which have increased the price, demand pull inflation. If the cost have increased, which have resulted increase in price, that is called cost push inflation. Any question in this regard? Next, we have business cycle. Before explaining business cycle, there's a question from previous slide, and the question was about point two. You asking this? Okay, we were discussing functions of tax, right? Government wants to discourage. When government wants to discourage certain activities, for example, government wants to discourage high CC cars like 3000 CC or 4000 CC. Government will apply more tax on 3000 CC as compared to 2000 CC. On 3000 CC, there would be more tax, and 2000 CC, there will be lesser tax. As a result, people will go towards the 2000 CC. And why government is discouraging? Because 3000 and 4000 CC creates more pollution. In order to stop pollution, government wants to discourage usage of high CC level cars. And this will also increase the fuel consumption, 3000 and 4000 CC. So government wants to discourage fuel consumption. Therefore, government wants to discourage higher CC cars. And in order to discourage higher CC cars, government will apply extra tax on higher CC cars. This is explanation of point number two. Is this clear to you? The student who asked for the point number two explanation and example. I hope this serves the purpose. Some products have social cost. For example, some products are not good for the society. They create problems for the society in longer perspective. But for example, smoking is not good, right? Government thinks that this is going to create a burden for society, right? It is not a healthy activity. So government wants to remove these things. That's why government put tax on it, right? Next, there is concept business cycle. this could be the four stages of business cycle, right? Let's write, for example, there could be a boom, right? There could be a recovery. Right, there could be a depression, there could be a recession, so when the economy of the country is moving up, let's start with the sequence. What is recession? Recession means the economy of the country is going down. Going down. Depression means the economy of the country is almost on bottom. Right? Recovery means the overall economy of the country is getting better results. Right? And if we talk about the fourth one, which is boom. Boom is all about when the economy of the country is on peak. That is what we call different stages of business cycle. Let me make it a different color so that it could be easier for you to understand. Any question in this regard? Next, we have unemployment. What is unemployment? Unemployment is a stage where people do not have job. Right? People have no employment. Right, and they are searching for jobs, that is called unemployment. Now the point is how to calculate this unemployment ratio, because every year the government calculates the unemployment ratio. Why? Because government wants to plan how many jobs are required to be created, because it is the prime responsibility of the government to increase jobs for the people. And for that purpose, governments needs to know what is the amount or what is the number of people who are searching for jobs, so that jobs can be created for them accordingly. Now, how to calculate it? Before understanding this, we need to understand one thing. For example, there's a country with 100 population. Right? And out of those 100 people, 80 can be considered as workforce, because these are the 80 people who wants to do the job and they're willing to do it. They can do the job. 20 are those people who are non-workforce. These include those people who are not willing to do job or they do not have the ability. These could be considered as kids, students, housewives, or we can say old age people of the society, those who are not willing, and also those who are not capable of doing the job. Those are called non-workforce. They are staying in the home they are staying in home because of their own will. And there are 80 people who wants to do the job. And out of those 80, 65 have job, 15 are jobless. On job and 15 are jobless. Unemployed, you can say. So in order to calculate unemployment in this country, we will say number of unemployed divided by total workforce. So in this example, we'll say number of unemployed 15 divided by workforce 80. get this point, 15 upon 80 multiplied by 100. This is the example. If you calculate number or rate of unemployment in this country, that makes it 18.75%. So we can say around 18-19% of the people of this country, 18.75% of the people of this country are not doing job, or they are looking for the job. So government has to look for them. They need to create 15 jobs or 15 million, whatever the figure is, for this 18% people are not working. So 15 million jobs are required to be created. There's a question from the student, and that question says, what about those unskilled people but wants to do the job? Okay, government needs to take action for them. For example, government should create training programs for them, right? So if there's a person in the economy in the country who does not have job, but they want to do the job, and but they don't have any skill, so government responsibility is to create training programs for them, right? So that they can be made skilled and they can look for job, because it is easier for a person who is skilled to get a job. Any question? Any question from the previous slides? Okay, gee, that's it. Thank you very much for being the part of this journey. I hope you have been all benefited from this P2P webinar. And I'm still available from that group. If you have some question regarding the today's lecture, especially for those who have not attended the last 1 hour of the P2P webinar, they can still ask any question related to this webinar in that WhatsApp group. And I hope you who have enjoyed the whole session. It is beneficial for you, especially today's MTQ part, in which we practiced some of the MTQs of the questions we just studied earlier. And I'm hopeful that you're going to pass your exams with good marks, as well as you will have more inside knowledge to the organizational overall behavior and that stuff. Thank you. Once again, Allah Hafiz.